Tonight on NewsWatch, the NRA heads to the White House. The latest on the meetings aimed at curbing gun violence in America.
Plus, Israelis prepare to head to the polls. What the election there could mean for the future of Israel.
And how one of America's most beloved presidents, Abraham Lincoln, wrestled with his faith. All this and much more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening, everyone. I'm Wendy Griffith.
And I'm Mark Martin. The vice president will hand President Obama early next week a number of suggestions to curb gun violence. But before that, Joe Biden continues to meet with dozens of groups having anything to do with the issue. Today, that included the most powerful opponent of more gun restrictions, the National Rifle Association. Paul Strand has tonight's top story from the White House.
Biden says he's reached no conclusions, but has a tight deadline with President Obama.
I committed to him I'd have these recommendations to him by Tuesday.
But Biden and his advisors seem to be closing in on some specifics, such as
universal background checks. Not just close the gun show loophole, but total universal background checks, including private sales.
At the same time as Biden's meeting, law enforcement types and politicians were gathered in Minneapolis at the summit to combat gun violence.
I've wondered for some time if anything bad enough could happen in the United States that might cause people to re-examine some of our gun laws. And just possibly 20 dead babies is it.
But in the day the VP was meeting with top gun advocacy groups like the National Rifle Association, he admitted there'll likely be pushback to some measures the White House may propose to Congress or implement on its own. Still,
even if what we do only saves one life, it makes sense. And I think we can do a great deal without in any way imposing on or impinging on the rights of the Second Amendment that the Second Amendment guarantees.
What the White House may not be prepared for is just how protective Americans are of those Second Amendment rights.
For instance, while it may feel there's no good reason for any citizen to own an assault rifle, many of those citizens may say they want one to defend their home, or to hunt, or to collect. Some even warn citizens may need those kind of guns if America's government should ever turn on its own people, or there's an apocalyptic breakdown in civilization. So almost any gun restrictions will surely face stiff resistance. Paul Strand, CBN News, the White House.
Today's meeting came as another school shooting took place, this time at a California high school. A 16-year-old is in critical condition. The shooter has surrendered.
President Obama is busy assembling his administration's cabinet for his second term in office. Today, he nominated Jack Lew to replace Treasury Secretary Timothy Geithner, who is currently serving as the president's chief of staff. He's said to be an expert on the federal budget and a tough negotiator. Some Republicans accuse Lew of not compromising in past battles over fiscal policy. Lew's nomination is also drawing a different kind of criticism against the Obama administration. For the first time in years, all of the top cabinet posts will be held by men. And some are voicing their opposition to the all-male group, a criticism the White House responded to.
Women serve in key policy roles here within the White House, as they do throughout the administration.
Besides Lew, the president has nominated Chuck Hagel for defense secretary, John Brennan to head the CIA, and John Kerry for secretary of state.
Washington will soon face the next debt ceiling battle in a few months. So Democrats have come up with a plan to help President Obama completely bypass Congress on the issue. It involves using the U.S. Treasury to print a $1 trillion coin. It's a move Phil Kirpin, president of the organization American Commitment, calls embarrassing and ridiculous.
We would be a laughingstock of the world if anything like this happened. I think it would actually be more embarrassing and more destabilizing to financial markets than simply going into a government shutdown type situation from not raising the debt ceiling. I think the confidence in the United States would plummet around the world. I think the confidence in the dollar would plummet around the world. And therefore, the value of the dollar would drop significantly, and you would see much higher prices pretty soon for just about everything that you purchase.
Kirpin says it's an attempt to take away leverage from Republicans. For the entire interview with Phil Kirpin, go to our website, cbnnews.com.
Unemployment is at a record high in Greece as the government there continues to slash salaries and increase taxes. The latest released jobless rates were just under 27%. That's a major increase from 19.7% at the same time a year prior. Greek youth have been the most affected, with over 56% of young adults between the ages of 15 and 24 out of work.
Tel Aviv was rocked by a car bomb today. Four people were injured by the explosion. The car was positioned near a bus, and the bomb went off close to the site of a bus bombing in November. It's not clear who was behind the attack, but Israel has a long history of bus bombings by Palestinian terrorists. Early reports indicate a motorcyclist was involved in placing the bomb.
In less than 2 weeks, Israelis go to the polls to decide the country's leadership and direction. This election comes at a crucial time, and it could have a major impact on how Israel responds to the changing world around it. Chris Mistral explains.
Israelis, like Americans 2 months ago, are being bombarded by political ads, including some messages with an edge for the young generation.
Like, they are starting to understand here in the party and the politicians that if you want, like, the youngest people to vote for you or to take the attention from them, so you need to do stuff. You need to do stuff like that.
Instead of a two-party system, more than 30 jam Israel's political landscape. They compete for 120 seats in Israel's parliament. Whoever wins the most seats must hammer together a coalition of 60 or more players to form the next government. Like the U.S., Israeli parties fall into the left or right. Dominating the right is the joint party of Benjamin Netanyahu and Avigdor Lieberman, called Likud Beitenu. On the left of the spectrum is the Labor Party. The potential spoiler of this campaign is Naftali Bennett and his Jewish home party. So far, he's hurting Netanyahu by appealing to concerns the current prime minister may give up land to appease U.S. and European leaders. Recently, Bennett explained his biblical view of the land of Israel to CBN News.
You know, we had a state in this very land 3,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, and now we have it again. That is profoundly important from a Jewish and biblical standpoint.
The latest poll shows Netanyahu's party still in the lead with 34 seats, Labor with 21 seats, and Bennett's Jewish Home Party at 15 seats. But as many as 30% of Israelis say they're still undecided.
The Israeli voter is a emotional voter. And he decides X and then he goes on his way to the election and he may change his mind.
That is why Netanyahu could face trouble.
I think Labor now has a chance of surprising. If we manage to get a blocking block of 60, we will be able to tilt the whole balance in Israeli politics, and we are not far away from that.
The Likud party maintains the country needs to stay the course.
Mr. Netanyahu needs, in my opinion, for the interest of the country, to stay in the lead. We are facing very, very powerful challenges in the near future.
It's likely Netanyahu will remain prime minister, but whoever leads Israel will face economic challenges at home, growing danger throughout the Middle East, and the often unwelcome presence of world opinion. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Thousands of people gathered today outside the presidential palace in Venezuela. They were there to support President Hugo Chavez in what's being called an alternative inauguration. The Venezuelan leader is recovering from cancer treatment and was too sick to return home for the event. The government organized today's inauguration and postponed his official swearing-in ceremony indefinitely. Even so, today marks the start of a new term for the president following his re-election in October.
President Obama is planning a symbolic twist during his oath of office for his second term. Mr. Obama will place his hand not on one Bible, but two. One owned by Abraham Lincoln and one owned by Martin Luther King Jr. The inclusion of King's Bible is significant because the inauguration falls on January 21st, the day we honor the slain civil rights leader. Mr. Obama used the Lincoln Bible when he took his first oath of office 4 years ago. Atlanta evangelical pastor Louis Giglio has pulled out of his role in President Obama's inauguration ceremony. He was just announced this week to give the benediction, but now he's been singled out for a sermon he preached against homosexuality. In a statement, Giglio says his prayer would be dwarfed by other agendas and that he doesn't think it would serve his core message. Giglio says, quote, "My aim has been to call people to ultimate significance as we make much of Jesus Christ."
Opponents of gay marriage are disappointed. The Washington National Cathedral will now host same-sex weddings. But they're not surprised. The Episcopal Church operates the cathedral, and the Family Research Council's president, Peter Sprigg, says that denomination has been moving away from Christian orthodoxy on the subject of sexuality for years. A spokesman for the National Organization for Marriage says this week's announcement from the church shows marriage is really an all-or-nothing deal. He says Americans must ask if they want to fundamentally give up traditional marriage.
School officials in one Ohio town are refusing to remove a large portrait of Jesus that hangs in a middle school. The painting is just like this one, and it was donated by a group of students to Jackson Middle School in 1947. The Freedom From Religion Foundation is demanding that the school remove it. They call the Jesus picture an unconstitutional endorsement of Christianity. But about 300 people showed up to support the painting at a school board meeting Tuesday night. The district superintendent says it has historical significance and will remain. Good for him or her. The portrait hangs in the school's Hall of Honor among numerous other faces.
Coming up, how cities across the country are working to contain the flu.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, New York.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore.
CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom, I'm there.
Embassy in Washington, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
It's probably something I've had for many years, and every year the PSA would be a little higher. I just kept kind of ignoring it. You know, one of those guy things. It'll go away. Finally, one day, Janet says, you're going to the doctor. They did a blood test. My PSA was 14. I needed to get a second opinion, so we contacted Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com.
The really great thing is that you just go online, and if you have prostate or lung cancer or whatever, you can see what their survival rates are.
You can also check for participating insurance plans. Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America go way beyond what normal hospitals do. I knew that they had the technology to take care of my cancer. It's a device called Calypso.
Calypso is GPS for the prostate. We're able to get four-dimensional, real-time tracking of prostate movement during radiation treatment.
It eliminates a lot of my side effects. It makes sense. It just makes sense. I own a deli. I'm back at work. My customers come in and say, gosh, you look good. And some of them say I look better now than I did before I left. I didn't expect to learn a lesson about how to treat people by being in a hospital. You can tell when somebody really cares.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits.
Binge drinking is a serious problem for women and girls, but oftentimes it goes under-recognized. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says about 1 in 8 women and 1 in 5 high school girls binge drink. For women, that means consuming 4 or more alcohol drinks in one sitting. The CDC warns binge drinking puts women at a higher risk for breast cancer, heart disease, sexually transmitted diseases, and unintended pregnancy. If a woman is pregnant, binge drinking can lead to fetal alcohol spectrum disorders and sudden infant death syndrome.
Cities across the country are scrambling to contain this year's flu virus. It's the worst outbreak in at least a decade. Thousands of people are infected. Emergency rooms are full. And now health officials say there could be a shortage of vaccines. George Thomas reports.
The actions of Boston Mayor Tom Menino illustrate just how severe this flu season is.
I am declaring a public health emergency in the city of Boston.
Boston health officials have confirmed 700 cases of the flu, That's 10 times more than all of last year's flu season. This time people started getting sick in October instead of January. The flu strain making most people sick is known as H3N2. It has a reputation for causing fairly severe illness, especially among older folks.
I can't say it enough. Please, all of everyone out there, get to the health centers this weekend. Get your flu shot.
But in some cities, that's no longer possible. 95% of the nearly 135 million doses of flu vaccines have already been distributed. Somerville, Massachusetts just ran out. And experts say it's only a matter of time before other cities follow suit. Children are being hit especially hard by the flu. At least 18 have already died. And now pediatricians say they're running low on flu mist, the nasal vaccine given to children who can't tolerate the flu shot. But while children and elderly are considered high risk, hospitals are being overrun by people with symptoms that can be treated at home.
Please, we implore you to stay home when you are sick.
Patients at Boston's Mass General are waiting up to 24 hours to be admitted. In Pennsylvania, one hospital set up a tent outside the emergency room to deal with flu patients. Despite the shortage of flu shots, many cities are now giving the vaccinations away for free in an attempt to fight the outbreak. Doctors say the shot is still the best defense against the flu. George Thomas, CBN News.
Up next, we'll look at how his faith impacted the life of President Lincoln.
White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put Struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Struts Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Struts Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on Struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12 year olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the Struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my Struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life changing. I wear them from the minute I get up to the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut Soul Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, callous feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back. But keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all, a $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes! Love my Struts, the best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
Struts, be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your Struts and Miracle Foot Repair for just $10 and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit GetStruts.com.
Well, the blockbuster Lincoln was nominated for 12 Academy Awards today. The film is just one example of the popularity of the beloved president.
Abraham Lincoln presided over the nation during the Civil War and he freed the slaves. But author Stephen Mansfield says he was also a man who struggled with faith.
Recently, Lee Webb spoke with him about his new book, Lincoln's Battle with God.
Stephen, people may not know that in his younger years, Abraham Lincoln was an atheist. I was surprised to hear that, and he rejected the very existence of God. Tell us about that phase of his life.
Well, Lincoln's parents were caught up in the revivals that sort of swept the Western frontier at that time, and it was very emotional, very sort of bombastic, and Lincoln didn't have a great relationship with his father, so he started to turn away from their Christian faith almost immediately. But then his reading, his eager mind turned him towards the writings of Paine and Volney and Gibbon, some of the rationalists of the time, and he just simply decided to become really the village atheist. He challenged everybody's faith. He wrote a little short manuscript against Christianity. I will say just in brief that his friends really said later that it wasn't so much that he didn't believe in God, he was mad at God because he thought his mother's illegitimacy made him somehow marked or somehow rejected. So atheism, reaction to his parents, and then of course feeling cursed by God, all of that mixed in, and he had a long atheist period.
How do you account for his conversion? What changed his thinking on the Christian faith?
You know, unfortunately, what changed his thinking were a series of deaths. He lost his mother. He lost sons. He said at one point in his life he was haunted by the thought of rain falling on graves. But in the providence of God, each time there was a significant death in his life, there was a minister of the gospel there to speak to him. And so he lost a child as he was living in Springfield. Mary, just his wife, just completely flipped out in her grief. But Abraham had a good minister who pulled in, shared the word with him, was a man gifted in apologetics, so he could answer Lincoln's objections, concerns, intellectual problems. And he began then to come to a deep and genuine faith.
Even after he came to faith, Stephen, did he wrestle with some of the fundamentals of the Christian faith?
He wrestled with every fundamental of the Christian faith. He was a smart man. He had read extensively. And quite frankly, in his age, especially in politics, preachers had often misbehaved and turned him off. And so he had to process every individual Christian doctrine for himself. Now, he did come towards a view and a belief in a sovereign God who ruled in the affairs of men. And of course, that's what leads to his great speeches like the second inaugural address and so on. But he was not a man who just accepted other men's testimony quickly. He was not a man who could just accept the traditional creeds uncritically. He had to study it out, research it on his own.
One of the anecdotes I find most fascinating is on the day he was assassinated, and you write that he said that he longed to go to Jerusalem to walk in the Savior's steps. Tell us about that.
You know, whenever we read about Lincoln's death at Ford Theater, almost always the final words are something like Mary Lincoln saying, you know, the young couple that we're with here in the box, they're going to be embarrassed by me clinging to you so. And Abraham Lincoln says, why, they will think nothing of it, you know, that kind of thing. But Mary said later that they were continuing a conversation they had had during the day, and that conversation was about what they would do after the war. And Lincoln had said, I don't want to go back to Springfield. I want to go abroad. I want to rest. I want to go to Jerusalem. And then he said, I want to walk in the Savior's footsteps. And depending on which version of Mary's story you hear, those may have been the last words Abraham Lincoln ever spoke.
Wow.
John Wilkes Booth Derringer ball entered his brain at that moment, and he never spoke again. So Lincoln was definitely on a journey, so much so he went from being village atheist to possibly his last words on earth being, I want to walk in the Savior's footsteps.
Well, the release of your book, Stephen, is timely because we're about to see the release of a new movie about Abraham Lincoln. You've had an opportunity to see an advanced screening of the movie. What was your impression of it?
Yes, I got to sneak out to L.A. and go to the screenwriter's preview. And I've got to tell you, it is a powerful, powerful film. I think it's a gift to our nation at this time in our history with a lot of the disillusionment and cynicism that's come out of the elections and recent politics and events. It's got a few small flaws. It doesn't do justice to the issue of faith, which is why I'm glad my book's on the market. But what a powerful film. How well done. What an attempt to honor our history. And Daniel Day-Lewis as Lincoln is, you know, they use this word all the time in reviews, but he's a revelation. He actually becomes Lincoln. Him sitting still is a more powerful reflection of Lincoln than almost anything you can read or see in any other film. It really is a must-see, and I think it's going to impact our country at this time in our history.
Stephen Mansfield is author of Lincoln's Battle with God, A President's Struggle with Faith and What It Meant for America. Stephen, it's always a privilege and pleasure to talk to you about the books you've written on the Christian faith and how it's affected us as a nation. Thanks for being with us to talk about Abraham Lincoln.
Lee, it's always good to be with you.
Up next, the biggest snowstorm to hit Israel in decades.
Listen up for an amazing offer that can change the way you hear.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Can you repeat that?
Frustrated with your hearing?
What did he say?
Well, hear better now. Introducing the fully rechargeable MSA30X, a revolutionary device that features the latest microsound amplification technology that can barely be seen. Independently tested to help you hear up to 30 times better. It turns ordinary hearing into extraordinary hearing. MSA30X works by capturing and amplifying sound waves, yet its lightweight ergoacoustic design is discreet. It form fits in and around either ear.
I forget I'm even wearing it.
And MSA30X is powerful. Hear clearly in restaurants. Never miss another word on TV or at the movies.
My wife complains that I have the volume up on the TV too loud.
And I didn't want to be in the same room with them.
Now I can hear everything clearly.
Simply adjust the volume as you desire. Other units use so many batteries and they're difficult to change. But the MSA30X is completely rechargeable. Simply plug it into the wall.
I tried other devices that had batteries, but they were always such a pain to change and so costly. But this is rechargeable, so I figure I save hundreds a year.
Bulky sound amplifiers can cost hundreds, but try MSA30X for just $59.95 and we'll include a cleaning brush and 5 comfort tips. But wait, in this special TV offer, we'll cut the price in half. Now you can hear up to 30 times better for just $29.95. But there's even more. We'll double the offer free. Just pay additional processing and handling. Wear them both or give one to a loved one. Did you hear that? That's 2 MSA30Xs for just $29.95. The MSA30X Hear Better Now offer. Get 2 for just $29.95.
All I can say is just try it. It could change your life.
To order the MSA30X sound amplifier, call 1-800-535-0654. That's 1-800-535-0654. Or you can go to msa30x.com. Call or go online now.
Well, the biggest storm to hit the Middle East in decades dumped at least 6 inches of snow on Jerusalem today.
Yeah, we sent CBN correspondent Julie Stahl out into the snow for this report.
Jerusalemites woke up to several inches of snow on the ground this morning, a winter paradise, wonderland, white all over the city, the old city, the new city. And as you can see, the snow has continued to fall on and off through at least half the day here. Now, it may not seem like snow is such a big deal to you, but Jerusalem only gets snow every 3 or 4 years. It snowed a little bit last year, but this particular snow happens to be the biggest snow we've had in 20 years. People are, of course, out building snowmen, having snowball fights. That's kind of a universal thing with snow. You know, in the book of Job, it says that God says that he has reserved the treasuries of the snow against the day of battle. Now, in history, Israel has often had a very wet winter after a war. Now, we had Israel had a war in November, and now it looks like they're heading for a very, very wet winter. Israel still has 2 months more of precipitation, so that they're enjoying the snow today. This is Julie Stahl for CBN News from a very cold and snowy Jerusalem.
Amazing. Isn't that cool how the Bible talks about that, the snow coming after the battle, and there was such a big battle, you know, around Thanksgiving, and gorgeous. I know they're loving it over there, and our boss is over there right now.
I know.
So he's getting to see Jerusalem under a blanket.
I'm a little envious, I must
admit. Me too. That's going to do it for us here on NewsWatch.
Yeah, thanks for watching. Have a great night.
Good night.